up the foundation of the early church. And again, we've been away from our study in Acts for a couple of weeks, but the critical things we've seen so far is the promise of Jesus that the power of the Holy Spirit would come upon them. We saw them experience that then in Acts chapter 2. And we've already seen Peter preach his sermon, and 3,000 people were added to the church. And we're going to see in this text, as the believers were committed to, devoted to certain principles, certain things, the Lord, as our last verse indicates, added to their number daily those that were being saved. I think it's an important distinction in terms of maybe some of the current culture of Christianity, at least in the West. The emphasis certainly in the last 30 years has been on the idea and adding to their number, period. Not so much that they're actually saved and discipled, but that's the implication of the text here. And so important that we focus on people coming to know the Lord, being discipled in the Lord, and sometimes our methods can actually work against what the Lord is trying to do. I love Chuck's tells a story again in the context of there's a couple of church growth models that are out there. One by its own admission, the West Coast version is based on a Fortune 500 marketing model, which works well, grows churches big. Also, non-Christian organizations and cult groups have used it, and it's worked for them as well and grown their organization. So that would leave you to believe it's the model and the marketing, not really a work of the Spirit. There's another model that's more the East Coast version, and their leader, after 30 years of growing churches into the thousands, actually did extensive surveys with their folks over a period of a year. And then came to the conclusion that people really weren't discipled in the Lord, and actually proclaimed their model kind of a failure. Of course, his was to come up with an additional program to remedy that situation. But again, there's the models that are out there, but here's the model for us. People being dedicated, committed to certain things. I just have to tell you my favorite Chuck story in regards to this. He was saying, and I don't know which church it was, but a church in Southern California kind of dedicated to what we might call the entertainment model. And so every Christmas they do a big outreach in what they call the singing Christmas tree. And I guess they build this artificial structure up front that looked like a tree that could hold a choir, and then the big orchestra, the whole thing. Every year it got bigger and bigger and so forth. And they had added, one of the last years they did it, in the grand finale, as the choir is singing, their final song, then a guy, he's, I don't know if he's spray painted gold or not, but he's dressed like an angel. He's got the wings and everything, and they're going to swing him by a wire, so big facility, high ceilings and stuff, and he's going to be the angel that swings out at the end. Apparently, they hadn't really worked this all out logistically, and so when that time came, they swung the guy out over the crowd. They kind of lost control a little bit, so he kind of would spin and move around a little bit too much, and they kind of picked the wrong guy. Turns out he has motion sickness. And there was a few people in the crowd that got baptized that morning. Not very pleasant. Pastor Chuck says, may that be the fate of all man's endeavors and programs, so that we learn to rely upon God and the power of his Holy Spirit to build the church and to do his work. So the focus here is on people together, again, in the word and fellowship, breaking of bread and prayer. Those are the things they were committed to. Well, let's read verse 42 and 43, the things that they were committed to. Then they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul. And many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. The word committed, sometimes translated devoted there, in the Greek means to be strong cords, to endure, to persevere, to be continually steadfast with a person or with a thing. I think we all admire professional athletes and their abilities, and at least understand to some extent that, man, it took a lot of commitment. It took a lot of dedication to be able to do what they do, whether it's on a Sunday afternoon at a football field or basketball game or a baseball diamond. It's, we see the outcome, but we don't see the hours and hours and hours of repetition that goes into it. I remember when I went out to college my freshman year, kind of following in my big brother's coattails, literally my big brother, and I think the only reason I got a scholarship is because I was his younger brother. So we were down there at school together in Southern California, and basically he was telling me, you know, you're a great defensive player, you do all these things well, but at the end of the season, they're going to look at your statistics, and then they're going to look at those and determine whether to renew your scholarship or not. So you just got to score more points. And so he kind of helped me with a few things, and then he said, and your free throw shooting is terrible, you know, so we've got to get you up at least at 75% or whatever. So it was school in the morning, lunch, basketball all afternoon, over to the cafeteria, eat, and then my brother would take me back to the gym, and he'd get a rack of balls out, and I would stand there and just shoot, you know, 50 at a time, 50 at a time, 50 at a time. But we did that every night, until I reached that and I could hit that at least 7 or 8 at a time every time. Sometimes I required some wind sprints in between, and we went on into the nights. And we studied sometimes, but because you can't play unless you can get the big C. That was that was my goal. And at any rate, dedication. It takes a lot of dedication to achieve something. And the idea here is that we can talk about Bible study and the Word of God. We can talk about the importance of fellowship, communion, or the breaking of bread, and prayer. And we would all simply agree, we could agree that those things are important. I don't think that anybody here would go, I don't see the importance of those things. I think we'd all agree they're important. But that's different than being dedicated to it. That's different than being committed to it. So again, they did certain things. They had certain attitudes that we're going to see. And then there was a certain outcome that prevailed as a result of it. But again, to see the commitment, the devotion at the beginning of it's important. Well, let's look at the first one. And that is, they were committed to the apostles' doctrine, to the apostles' teaching. And again, there's a 100% Jewish church, obviously, at this point. And they would, from their birth, have been studying the Word of God. But now the Word of God is different to them, because the Word of God comes alive to them, because they've been born again of God's Spirit. They're not just reading about a Messiah that might come. They know who he is. They're not just reading about this day when the new covenant would come that Jeremiah promised. They're part of the new covenant. It all comes alive. And maybe you've had that same experience if you kind of grew up in a church and you knew the Bible stories and you knew some things, but you really weren't saved. And then you came to faith in Christ. It really does come all alive to you. I can just remember we just finished Christmas. The first Christmas as a believer is kind of cool because those are those are all worship songs, and those are all songs about my salvation. It's all completely different, and that's the way it was for these men and women here. One literal translation would say they were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. It's all present tense here. They were constant about studying the Word of God. And this should be, apparently, the normal experience of conversion. A desire to know what the Bible says. And I know that it was like that for Kathy and I. And I think part of it was because we had been so entrenched in the New Age movement, all the isms of the 60s and the 70s and so forth. When you finally find something that's really the truth, you want to know all about it. Yeah. If the God that sent his son to die on the cross for my sins and has forgiven me of everything that I've done, he has written something, well, that ought to be pretty important in terms of my time and my priorities to figure out what it says and what it means to me. And this is a guy that doesn't read much or hardly at all. But I needed to learn so that I could read the Bible. It's really the backbone of a healthy Christian life. Peter puts it this way. 1 Peter 2:2 is an illustration. He says, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the word that you may grow thereby. if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. If you come to know the grace of God, it should be the normal process. He says, like a newborn baby wants its mother's milk, in that same way, you should want to know the Word of God, know the Bible, and study the Word of God. The early church was not anti-intellectualism. They studied, and they understood the Word of God in its context, and it, certainly how it applied to them. And we should be the same. And we've got so much more available to us. We've got CDs, and we've got MP3s, and we've got the internet. We really want to saturate, or should want to, our minds with the Word of God. Paul says in Romans 12, do not be conformed any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed from it. Different. How? By the renewing of your mind. He says, then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is good and pleasing and perfect will. But how do we renew our mind? It's primarily through the Word of God to get that Christian worldview and perspective on life, to be strengthened in the Word of God. Secondly, they were committed to fellowship. The word in the Greek is koinonia, and it simply is that's the best we can do to say the word fellowship. It means a lot more than that. It means a coming together, an interrelating, becoming a part of each other, a strong bond, a tie, a communion, a commonness, a fellowship. It has to do with having a relationship with God. Because we have koinonia, or fellowship with God, then we're able to have fellowship with one another. Every time the word is used in the New Testament, it denotes some kind of sharing, either of someone or something. Usually a collection, a contribution, or this person helping that person. But it's not simply the idea that we use it in the Christian vernacular to say that, yeah, we're going to come down and meet at the church and have fellowship. Probably means we're going to drink some godly drink like coffee and then talk to each other or something. But that's good, that's fine. But this is the idea. This fellowship means that we are giving of ourselves to someone else, to another person. So if you want to have Christian fellowship, just give yourself away. That's how you get involved in, quote, true fellowship. John puts it this way in his first epistle, chapter 1, verse 3. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship, that's our word, koinonia, with us. And truly our koinonia, our fellowship, is with the Father, with the Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be full. John is saying that in the same way that because of our salvation, we can have fellowship, koinonia, with God the Father, with Jesus Christ. It's the same way that we can have fellowship with one another, a giving of ourselves one to another. This is very important because of some of those things I've just mentioned, because of the internet and the MP3s, and we're being, we're webcasting even as I speak. And we certainly recognize the value in getting the Word of God out there to the world and people that don't have access to it any other way. And we're thankful for the technology. But it's not a substitute. And people can begin to think that it is a substitute. Because the problem is, of course, when you come to church, you're with a bunch of sinners, And we're all pretty convinced that everybody is probably just not radically, but just a little bit worse than us. And so it makes it hard to get along sometimes, because sometimes we act like sinners around each other. We say things that hurt one another's feelings. We do things that offend one another. Praise God, it's not a lot, but it does happen. It just does happen. And it can drive people actually out of churches. I meet people all the time, and they're not in fellowship because, well, somebody said this to me, or that person did that, or I was disappointed by that. And you know what? Welcome to the club. It's just going to happen. But that's actually not a reason not to fellowship. It's actually a reason to fellowship, because we're all the same. Last time I checked, Jesus is the only one that walked on water. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the only way that we can express God's fellowship that we have with him is through other people. Carmen Renee Berry wrote a book called The Unauthorized Guide to Choosing a Church. And she talked about the fact that she grew up in a church and basically became cynical. Because in her eyes, child youth eyes, she saw people in the church that really didn't live out their Christian experience in an authentic way. And certainly that's a problem and an issue. But she writes in the book, "I'd overlooked one essential factor." So she had nothing to do with the church. She said, "I overlooked one essential factor, that I am as finite and flawed as everyone else. When a friend committed suicide, I realized I had become too cynical, too lost, and too alone. I needed a church, a community of believers. I needed to live in my faith and visit my doubts." Something happens there that just simply doesn't happen when you're alone in prayer or on the internet. As much as I hate to admit it, my faith is enhanced and enlarged when in relationship with other less than perfect human beings. There's no getting away around it. Because in concert together, we absolutely can love and support one another, and that's an awesome thing. But we can also get hurt and learn to deal with it and not become bitter and actually forgive people and grow through circumstances and become more mature and more perfect Christians, which is Christ, what he wants us to do. But it won't happen if we believe it's a good idea. It'll only happen if we're absolutely committed to it. Because there'll be a lot of forces out there spiritually to try to dissuade people from being in fellowship one with another. But it's so important. Paul writing to the church in Corinth in his second epistle, he's concerned over the financial need back in Jerusalem. We're going to talk about it a little bit more because we're going to see that they're a caring church as well. But keep in mind that in this Jewish context, when a person came to faith in Jesus as the Messiah, then they were typically, like an Orthodox family today, were ostracized and were put out. That meant that they lost their job because they worked for their father who worked for their father who worked for their father and so on. Everybody learned a trade from their father, and usually everything was a family business. So you lost your job, sometimes you lost your home. Then add to that, in the first century, there was a tremendous drought in this area. So the believers in Jerusalem were hurting, say the least, financially. Paul's aware of it, and so he's out in the Gentile areas, Macedonia, southern Turkey, Greece, and these areas. And they're not doing so great either, but he's taking up an offering to bring back to the church in Jerusalem. And he says this about it in chapter 8, verse 1, 2 Corinthians. "Moreover, brethren, we made known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia. Then in great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability," yes, beyond their ability, they were freely willing, "imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. And not only as we had hoped, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us, by the will of God." He ties together these ideas they're hurting as well, but they urged us, they compelled us to come, get this offering, because we want to help them, because we want to have koinonia, we want to have fellowship. So this idea of fellowship, koinonia, is definitely tied to this idea of giving yourself. It might be financially, but a lot of times it's your time and your energy. And again, if you want to have true Christian fellowship with someone, you've got to be willing to give of yourself to another person. And they didn't think it was a really good idea. They were absolutely committed to it. Again, what's the outcome? The Lord then is able to add daily to the church so they could have a big church. No, those that were being saved. And obviously, they come into this context and they're being discipled. Thirdly, they were committed to the breaking of bread. And I'll give you three quick reasons why I think it's not simply eating together, although I'm sure that they did that, and we have a reference to that in verse 46. But in verse 42, again, this idea of breaking the bread is tied together with two religiously loaded terms, fellowship and prayer. And in verse 46, it separates the term breaking bread, or they broke bread, and they also, in a sense, ate together. It separates those two terms. And then, of course, here we've got the pronoun, the breaking of the bread. So communion, what we know as communion. It was, they were committed to gathering together and taking communion. the little irony in this, because of the lights going out earlier, we won't be having communion this morning. I just thought I'd mention that. But we're dedicated to it. And we're going to do it next week so we can do it together as a church. It's important to remember the Lord's table, to remember the price that was paid for our sins, to never forget the cost of our salvation, and to remember the new covenant that we're under, no longer under the law. Was that a big issue if you were Jewish in the first century? That was a big issue. And they constantly had to remember that because, again, on the night before he died, Jesus took that bread and he broke it and said, "This is my body." He took that cup and said, "This is the cup of the new covenant." No longer under the Mosaic covenant. No longer under the Mosaic law. The new covenant promised by Jeremiah. And they got to experience that new covenant. We're new covenant believers. We're not under the law. And we need to be reminded often of the price that was paid for our sins. Jesus' blood, his body broken and poured out. The new covenant that we're under. And of course, we always like to say it's a look into the future, because Jesus changes the metaphor there. In that Passover Seder, when he says, "And I will not drink the fruit of the vine until I drink it with you anew in my Father's kingdom," which is a term that a groom would express to his to-be bride. We're engaged, and I will not drink like this in celebration. I'm going away, and I won't drink of it again until I come and you become my wife. And so it's a look into the future. One day there'll be the marriage supper of the Lamb that we'll experience. So communion is definitely a look into the past, a look into the present and the future, and we need to be committed to the ideas that it represents and what it means to us personally. Fourthly, they were committed to prayer. And what I've done for you is just kind of give you a little acronym to maybe help you with your prayer life. And I know that we should pray without ceasing. As Paul says, just a constant conversation, with the Lord during the day. And as Peter says, casting our cares upon him because he cares for us. But there needs to be some times when we're a little more deliberate about it. Not just, "Lord, I need a parking place here. And, I don't see one coming up here." So if you get, we all pray those kind of prayers, and that's fine. That's fine. And the Lord can sometimes provide those parking places and whatever it might be. Safety on the way to work, whatever it is, driving the traffic. But there needs to be something a little more deliberate. Some times where you just set aside, and now I'm going to pray, I'm going to spend time with the Lord. And you might use this acronym of ACTS. That's our book study here. A would stand for adoration or worship. Important to spend time just praising God for who he is. And again, that's where the Psalms can be so helpful. "I'm not really sure what to say." Well, cheat. Just say what David said. He was pretty good at it. Read a psalm as he declares his praises to the Lord. "Praise the Lord, you saints of his. Praise his holy name. His anger lasts a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may remain for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Lord, I just praise you because maybe I've experienced a little touch of that anger, but I'm so thankful for your grace that lasts a lot." You just use the Psalms. Praise the Lord. C is for confession. Again, asking for forgiveness. When we come to faith in Christ, he does forgive us of all of our sins, past, present, and anything in the future. He forgives us 100% by his grace. But it's still good to stay current with the Lord and recognize the fact that I do sin. I do blow it. I don't always say the right things, have the right attitudes. I don't always represent Christ well in the home or out there in the community. Lord, please forgive me. Cover me with your blood once again, Lord. Refresh me. Paul, we're going to hear a sermon from Peter here in chapter 3 about repentance and the refreshment that it can bring to our souls. Again, the classic 1 John 1:9, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and will purify us from all unrighteousness. And again, that's in a perfect tense. It's just an ongoing thing, staying current with the Lord. T for thanksgiving. Certainly We have a lot to be thankful for, and more than on a holiday once a year. It's an attitude that we need to really foster and to develop. And again, I've mentioned it before, but when the kids were little, when I would pray with them at night, I would ask them what they were thankful for that day. It's interesting the things they're thankful for and stuff. You know, kind of would bring up some good conversations and everything. But that's a good thing to say. What are you thankful for? And then, hey, whatever. Let's give thanks to the Lord for what He's done today and so forth. Because that's an attitude that needs to get developed to be thankful people. And then supplication is we could actually use the S for shopping list. Because it is the things that are concerning to us and what's going on daily in our lives and the stresses of life and the things that we need to bring for the Lord. Certainly, we need to do that. But they were committed to prayer. Again, not just the idea of prayer, but to setting aside time to pray. We're going to see the apostles and how they still went to the temple at the times of prayer. They had designated times when they were with the Lord. We keep in mind in the context of prayer, the prayer is always to accomplish God's will, never to get my will done. I might have my ideas and the things I want to see happen, but it's always to get God's will done. As Jesus prayed in the garden, not my will, but thy will be done. Sometimes as I spend time with the Lord in prayer, I can find the things I was praying for actually change. And I kind of recognize, yeah, I kind of get that. That's probably not a real good idea. Just kind of scratch that other part here. And that's the idea of prayer, is that we're with the Lord and He can minister to us and begin to direct our prayers. I love this poem, and I don't know the source for it, but it talks about one person's prayer life here. It says, he prayed for strength that he might achieve. He was made weak that he might obey. Prayed for wealth that he might do greater things. He was given infirmity that he might do better things. He prayed for riches that he might be happy. He was given poverty that he might be wise. He prayed for power that he might have the praise of men. He was given weakness that he might feel the need of God. He prayed for all things that he might enjoy life. He was given life that he might enjoy all things. He received nothing that he asked for, but all that he hoped for. Because sometimes we don't know what we're doing in life, in our own decisions, and what we think would be good for us and so forth. But God does. And as we surrender things to Him in prayer, it's amazing how He can bring wonderful things about in our lives. Verse 43 mentions signs and wonders. Many wonders and signs were done through the apostles, and we're going to be reading about them and looking at them in our study. Excuse me, but praying for a little voice miracle here. Two things about the signs and wonders that we'll see in the book of Acts. One is, signs and wonders, we say, followed them. They did not follow after signs and wonders. In other words, they weren't looking for the next big show in town and running this way or that way. It was just a natural occurrence when miracles happened. The other thing is that we're talking about a period of time a little less than 30 years. In this room, we could probably go around. Some of us have been Christians for 30 years. Some of us less. We could probably put together a pretty good book of Acts of miracles that God has done in and through our lives over the years, and have some great stories to tell of God's faithfulness and things that He's done. Or we could say, well, there's been many coincidences, things that just happened to occur and that worked out in our favor. And sometimes I'm afraid that we do that. Again, I understand that a miracle by its definition is a supernatural. It's beyond the natural of what could occur and happen and so forth. And God still moves in, certainly in that arena. But I think it's important to recognize the smaller miracles that He does and give thanks for them, not simply write them off as a mere coincidence. I was thinking about this because of the holidays, and Melissa made several of my mom's recipes, like her red velvet cake and So I was talking to my dad about that. He said, well, your sister made that too. We had it here. And your other sister up in Oregon, she made the same thing. So it was kind of cool. We're all, you know, kind of spread apart. We're all eating mom's red velvet cake, you know. And, you know, and as I have to admit, there's a little part of it that, you know, taste isn't a great memory trigger, but it still is a memory trigger, you know. And thinking about my mom, she went to be with the Lord several years ago. It brought to mind one of these coincidences that occurred. My brother-in-law, Strat, good you, Strat, was with Gospel for Asia. He and Dree were living there in Texas, and at the time he was traveling 3 weekends a month all over the country. I mean, it's, get an email from him, he's in New York. The next time he's in Florida, then he's in San Diego, and he's at a Calvary Chapel, and he's at a Mennonite church somewhere in Pennsylvania or something, all over. Every weekend. And he happened to be in Napa Valley at a Calvary Chapel there. Gave his presentation on behalf of Gospel for Asia for their Bridge of Hope program for the kids and supporting the missionaries and so forth, like he's done with us many times. And of course then went with my dad and, you know, all my siblings that attend the Calvary there, and went back to see my mom, who's really on the respirator. She's having heart failure, and she's really close to the end. We had just been up there and spent time with them and with my mom, and actually planned out with her whole memorial service, the songs that would be sung, what she wanted me to say in my message, and the whole deal. And she was not doing well, and she was ready to be with Jesus. You know, she was looking forward to that. But here on this particular Sunday, Strat was able to go and just really beautifully minister to the family and pray with them and with my mom. And they've come to Hawaii a lot over the years. He knew them all very well. It was just that my dad called it right afterwards. A very, very sweet time. And then my mom went to be with the Lord less than 3 days later. And you could say, well, that was a wonderful little coincidence that Travis travels all over the country, but he just happened to be in Napa right at that period of time. Well, that's a miracle. Yeah, I couldn't get on the plane and fly up there on that Sunday afternoon or get there in time, but God provided somebody else, and somebody else that was part of our family. And I just thought of that illustration rather than maybe somebody being healed of cancer, because I've got those stories too. You know, the gals that couldn't conceive that now have a family. I've got those stories too. God moves in the miraculous today like he did with the apostles. That didn't stop somehow in the book of Acts. But at the same time, I just don't want us to overlook the smaller miracles, and that we would recognize that when we're living out the normal, natural Christian experience devoted to these things that are given to us here, there's some pretty cool things that follow us, that just naturally occur in our lives and those around us. Well, these were things they were committed to, they were devoted to. Secondly, they were caring. This is certainly an important ingredient in verse 44. Now, all who believed were together and had all things in common and sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So they cared for others. And this caring, first we want to know, it was never forced, and it was motivated by love. When it's forced, we call that communism or socialism, when the government comes in and takes your stuff and gives it to someone else, what we call redistribution of wealth. When that happens, that's called socialism or communism. That's not what's going on here. They were just simply motivated by love. People were hurting because of the conditions that I mentioned, because of being ostracized from their family, sometimes losing their home, losing their jobs, and so forth. Other people pitched in and helped them. It was a particular situation that they faced at this particular time. We don't find it to be the norm throughout the book of Acts, nor in any of the other churches. But they did it here at this time. And the takeaway for us is just to see their heart, that they're caring people. Now, did they give everything away? No, because in verse 46, we've got them meeting in homes. So not everybody sold all their homes and so forth. In Acts 5, we've got Barnabas, and then this sweet couple, Ananias and Sapphira. We're going to meet them later. And they sold some property. So, again, they didn't like, hey, I'm a Christian, I'm selling everything I've got, you know, and taking it down and laying it at the apostles' feet. No, they didn't do that, but they were very caring towards one another, not forced, but motivated by love. And as I mentioned, secondly, motivated on a particular occasion. A Greek rendering tells us it was a specific occasion and not an everyday experience. And again, these conditions got worse as a drought came into that part of the Middle East in the first century. We know that historically as well as the biblical text. Thirdly, we would say to us, our caring for others needs wisdom. We need wisdom today because of the kind of the condition the country's in, the sense of entitlement that people have. We've got people panhandling out left and right on about every major intersection, even in our little town right here in Kailua and so forth. We've got a growing homeless problem existing here. And if you haven't driven up the west side just to drive up and check it out, it's amazing or appalling, or you know, it takes your breath away to see how extensive are the numbers of the people that are living on the beach. According to a state government survey that was done under the Lingle administration by Duke Iota, they found the following, that about a third of the people that are out there that are homeless is because they're alcoholics or drug addicts, and that's why they're there. There's another third of them because they're mentally ill. They should be institutionalized on meds and where somebody can have some watch care over them. But because of some legislation that was passed a number of years ago on the federal level, that unleashed these people out onto the streets and they can't be held against their will. That'll always exist unless that is reversed legislatively. There's another third of people that are out there that are actually, though, just hardworking people. Mom and dad work a job, the kids go to school, and they're living on a tip. But they don't make enough to be able to afford the rent here in the islands. And those people can really legitimately be helped. So because of these conditions, we really need to exercise some wisdom. The Bible has a lot to say about this area. Paul in 2 Corinthians 8, verse 13, again, in regards to this idea of the offering and helping others, says, "For I do not mean that others should not be eased and you burdened, but by inequality, that now at this time your abundance may supply their lack, and their abundance also may supply your lack, that there may be equality, as it is written, he who gathered much had nothing left over, he who gathered little had no lack." So he's saying that there are times in our lives as believers when we're particularly blessed and so forth. And when we are, it's a good idea to look around and say, is there anybody else that needs help, somebody else that I can support and help in terms of a need? Paul says in 2 Thessalonians 3:10, "For even when we were with you, we commanded you this." Okay, here's the caveat. "If anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. For we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busy bodies. Now those who are such we command and exhort through the Lord Jesus Christ that they work in quietness and eat their own bread." So in terms of do I help the guy on the street that's panhandling? I would say no. Because it's difficult to judge whether the person is capable of working or incapable. There are certainly people that would love to be able to work that are not capable, and they need help. Of course, the government is helping by taking about a third of our money away to do it. At any rate, we're thankful for the social programs that help people that are incapable of working. The person that is capable of working and is not working, the Bible says, don't help them. It's pretty straightforward, pretty clear. They need to be out there in exercising this old concept called personal responsibility. And it's an old antique idea that we've kind of lost in our culture. And it's like my dad says, everybody's got a job. If you don't have a job, then your job is finding a job. You get up and you go out 8 hours looking for a job. If you don't find one, you get up the next day and you spend 8 hours looking for the job. You don't just take any job. You take any job you can get, and that's your job till you get the next job, till you get the next job. But everybody's got a job. So there's no such thing as unemployment. It's just some people are a little more dependent upon the Lord than others. just my dad, I'm just saying. But you know, it's a biblical concept. And so it makes it a little difficult sometimes. And we're thankful for ministries like River of Life and others, like Pastor Cliff's ministry, Loaves and Fishes, Feeding the Homeless in Waimanalo and out on the west side, because we're not really sure what to do sometimes. And you can get taken advantage of by folks that are pretty street smart. I've heard some unbelievable stories why I should give money to people, and you probably have too. And so it's good to be able to just, you want to help, be generous. You've got the ability, just funnel it through people. That's what they do. That's their ministry. And that's all done with the gospel and for the glory of God. Why help? Well, Proverbs 22:9. He who has a generous eye will be blessed, for he gives his bread to the poor. In Luke, Jesus tells us, sell what you have and give alms. Provide yourselves money bags which do not grow old, a treasure in the heavens that does not fail, where no thief approaches, nor moth destroys, nor stock market ever falls. I just threw that in. Where your treasure is, there your heart be also. To be generous. Again, Proverbs 28:22. A man with an evil eye hastens after riches and does not consider that poverty will come upon him. The guy with the generous eye is generous. The guy with the evil eye, or you're, oh, I think that guy just gave me the evil eye. No, it just means he's stingy. The guy that's stingy, and hastens after riches, actually poverty is going to come upon him. So we too should be caring people. We should avoid the get-rich-quick speculator. We're under no obligation to help the person who will not work, that should be working. But certainly there are times when we can help the genuine needy person. And we're fortunate to be in Hawaii, which is a very giving and a very generous culture. So a lot of this, I'm telling you, but a lot of this is just done normally and naturally because of the culture that we're kind of brought up in. That's something to be thankful for. And I've experienced it, it's amazing. Just a little side note, when I was actually living in a tent in Nanakuli, I would, hard to believe, I'd be walking down Farrington Highway. Of course, I look like something a dog drug in. You know, the image is like, I look like I should be on Duck Commanders. I look like Duck Dynasty guy. Absolutely. That's what I look like. I just didn't have camos on. It was flipper shorts and a t-shirt. And I look like I could use a meal, too. I wasn't walking with the Lord. I was doing drugs, and I was eating very little. And I don't even want to tell you how much lighter I was then. But I was a lot lighter. I'd actually have people at their front yards barbecuing and actually call me and have me come in and eat lunch with them. Well, Brody, you look like you can use a meal. Brody, come on over here. You know that, hey, come eat my house. That's not something a termite does, of course. But what they mean by that is actually to come in and eat with them. I'm a total stranger. Howdy, no less. Total stranger in Valakuli on more than once. Looking back, it's amazing. That's a culture that we're part of, but it's to be part of who we are as Christians, a committed, caring. And then the third thing is the consistency, verse 46. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. So again, when the Lord adds, it's because people are being saved. He's adding because people are committed, caring, and consistent. Notice they're consistent in their lifestyle. They met in the temple. Again, they were no longer taking part in the sacrificial system, but they were there for the times of prayer. And again, the Temple Mount is several acres. It's a huge area. There were designated places for teaching and discipleship and so forth. So it was a place where they could go and fellowship and preach and teach and disciple. And they continued to do that. But notice they also then met in homes, big on home fellowships. The point is they were consistent. They were the same in the home as they were in public. What they were doing in church, it was how they were at home. The idea of this consistency is so important. And again, they remained in the churches, living during a time of persecution that would continue up until the mid-4th century or so. Secondly, they were consistent in their attitudes. Notice it was with gladness and simplicity of heart. Gladness means exultation, exuberant joy. They were sincere. 47, they were praising God, so they were worshipers. And then thirdly, they were consistent in their influence, having favor with all the people. And, you know, despite the media, which is really, really slanted against Christianity, whether it's TV or television, well, you know, once in a while, you know, there's they allow a Christian to be the good guy, but it doesn't happen very often. And anyway, we were just watching a movie the other night, and there's this beautiful prayer going on in this scene of these guys crossing the desert and prayer that they'll make it, and then the scene passes, and it's the evil bad guy that's saying the prayer over dinner. That's who those Christians are. Anyway, it's interesting, the stuff that's in the media that's pretty subtle sometimes, sometimes not so subtle. Jesus said that the persecution would come to believers through two sources. It would come through religious leaders, and they certainly saw that in the first century. We get that today. We got the liberal guys that have stopped being Christians like 60 years ago. They come after, you know, the us evangelical Christians, you know, all the time and so forth. And then government leaders, they had it under Rome. We're getting a little more of it, certainly, in our day as well. But despite that, they were still able to have favor with people, because I think the people realized that they were consistent in their lifestyle. They were really genuinely caring people. And of course, that all happened because they were committed to being in the Word and to prayer and to fellowship and to breaking of bread. All these things worked in concert together. And the church grew out of this very simple foundation of being committed to these things. I just wanted to close with a statement from Pastor Chuck. He says, when the church was what God wanted the church to be, then God did for the church what he was wanting to do. When we do what the Lord wants us to do, then he can jump in and do what he wants to do. And but it's kind of hard for him to do that. And you probably have that with your own kids, you know. It's like there are times when you just really want to do something very cool for your kids, and then they're just kind of misbehaving. It's like, oh, man, are you kidding me? You got some cool thing all planned. You're going to take them to some, you know, see, you know, some special, you know, Scottish restaurant that they like to go to, and, you know, something like that. And, you know, you got something all planned for them that you know that they're going to be all excited about, and then they misbehave. It's just hard, you know, just kind of, that. God wants to do some awesome things. He wants to save people. He wants to impact the community around us. And he's just saying, don't just believe in these things and agree with them, but if you'll actually be committed to them, you'll be amazed what I'll do in your midst. And the natural occurrence is that there'll be signs and miracles and some very cool things that will just kind of follow you around. Some of these wonderful coincidences that he wants to cause to happen. But he's asking us if we'll be committed to these things, be dedicated to them. One last little closing thing. I read this quite a while ago. It was at the time that the movie The Passion of the Christ came out a number of years ago. I was just curious how many of you saw the movie. Quite a few. And it's, you know, I bought the DVD then. I had never watched it. I mean, it's just so brutal. It's just, you know, I probably should watch it like once a year. I probably should just make myself. It's tough to watch, to really see visually pretty accurately, you know, what Jesus Jesus went through. And of course, a lot of people, I think, probably came to know the Lord through that filming. And one writer, a pastor, was saying that he just watched the movie, took a bunch of folks from the church, saw the movie, and he came home and he picked up the mail. He went to his house and he's going through it. One was an invitation to a church that's in his area. So he's kind of curious. So he opens the thing, and they listed in this little mailer all the things that made them unique as a church. And he states it said the following: no religious dogma. We encourage the freedom of individual thought and belief, a humanist view of life. warm and accessible. Our Sunday services typically include a mix of readings and music, moments of meditation, contemplation, and a sermon. Our children's religious educating program, we teach our kids to be accepting of different beliefs and the importance of each person seeking his or her own truth. And he goes on, if you're looking for a congregation that cherishes freedom, belief, and opinion with a warm sense of community and fellowship, please visit us. And then he writes the following. He says, I had watched the horrific suffering of Jesus and heard him say, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Hour later, I opened an invitation to visit a group where truth doesn't matter. The contrast was overwhelming. We'll never reach anybody by compromising the standards of the Bible or the truth of God's Word. Actually, people are looking for the authentic, real deal. And so we can be caring, but we can be committed to the truth of God's Word. And that's how we're really going to reach those around us. Amen?
The light of